بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. I am Dr. Ahmed Elsaeed. I am oral surgeon and I have diploma in infection control. I would like to thank Dr. Mazen Adomani for giving me the second opportunity to be part of this International Dental Congress in its fourth season. My topic today will be the dental management of the medically compromised patient or patients. It's actually a very important topic to each doctor in the dental clinic. I will start by a very important question. Why most of the dentists become afraid when they receive a patient with medical problem, or when they receive a patient who is under some medications? Why dentists become panic when they know that their patients are taking antiplatelet drug, or that the lady is pregnant, or that their patient is diabetic, and some of them refuse to treat such type of patients, despite most of the medically compromised patients can be treated safely in the dental clinic with the simple precautions. Okay, this is a very important link through which you can download a PDF file which includes a summary of the most medical emergencies in the dental clinics. This summary, you have to keep it in your drawer on the clinic or under the glass of your table, so you can manage the medical emergencies in the dental clinics and remind you with the most important precautions that you have to take. Okay. Medical history. When we open the file for the patient, we take a medical history. So why we are taking a medical history for the patient? Actually, the medical problem may help in the diagnosis of the dental problems, because sometimes the oral disease is a manifestation of a systemic disease. And also, there are some precautionary measures that are sometimes indicated before starting the dental treatments. And some patients need pre-medications or controlling before we start for them the dental treatment. Sometimes we need a medical consultation in some cases to get a consent from the treating physician. Either we can treat this patient normally, or we need a further precautions. And the dental treatment sometimes affect patient's systemic health. Sometimes we can do some dental treatment that has adverse effect on the patient health. The most common example is the subacute bacterial endocarditis. The patients with prosthetic valve, we can promote the subacute bacterial endocarditis if we start the medical the dental treatment for this medical problem. Okay, so we have to prescribe for such patients a prophylactic antibiotics according to the protocols. And also for the screening of systemic diseases like diabetic and hypertensive patients, sometimes we need just to measure the blood pressure and run the blood sugar before starting our dental treatment. Okay, so I mentioned that sometimes we need a medical consultation before starting our dental treatment. So why we are doing a medical consultancy in dentistry? Sometimes the dental practice require a cooperation between you as a dentist and patient's physician. The referral to physician may be necessary to verify the patient's systemic conditions and to obtain clearance or to obtain consent. And sometimes, again, it aids in the diagnosis of the patient. Sometimes we know the diagnosis of the oral disease from proper knowing of patient's systemic health. The written medical consultation, and we have to stress on the word written, because the dealing between you as a dentist and physician should be in a written way. Why? For a medical legal aspect. Patient will claim later that he is not copped for your dental treatment, and he should take precautions to the written medical clearance from his physician can protect you. Okay, when we are managing the systemic diseases of the patients, we will find the word stress reduction protocol in most of the systemic diseases. You will read number one, please follow the stress reduction protocol for hypertensive patients, for patients with angina, for patients with MI, for diabetic patients, for patients under corticosteroid therapy. For most of patients, you will read stress reduction protocol. So what is the stress reduction protocol? It composes of three elements. The first element is before treatment, second element is during, and lastly after treatment. So before treatment of most of the medically compromised patients, we sometimes need to prescribe a sleeping pills one night before surgery, but this is optional and conditioned. Not in all cases we can give sleeping pills. This according to patient systemic health, and according to sometimes we need also to consult his physician either the sleeping pills are suitable to him or not, according to the taken medications by the patients. And also the day of the surgery, just before the patient enter the clinic, for some patients we have to prescribe a short acting barbiturates to keep the patients calm and to reduce patients' fear from dental treatment. And please make your appointment or schedule an early short appointment for the patient. So by this, now your patient became calm and he is ready for your dental treatment. What else you have to do during your procedure? Please make a light voiced Quran Kareem or any light voiced something which causes relaxation of the patient. I think Quran Kareem with some voices like our Egyptian reciter Abdul Basit Abdul Samad or Al Husari, I think with a very light voice it causes some relaxation of the patients and keep him calm. The reassurance of the patient and discussing the treatment with him and instructing him that our treatment is a simple treatment and we are not doing a fearful procedure, it's very important. Please avoid surprises of the patient. Avoid to do him any surprise. Suddenly, today we will do extraction for this tooth and it's not in the plan. Today I will do blah blah blah, I will do filling, I will do anything that is not scheduled in this dental treatment or in this dental visit. Please avoid surprises to such type of patients. And please avoid unnecessary noise and the high noise. Even your mobile ringtone, please keep your mobile silent during dental treatment. No need that while the handpiece is working and then suddenly your mobile will ring. Patient will become afraid. He's already afraid and you are increasing his fear. So no need to make him more afraid. Please also keep down instruments out of patient sight. No need that the patient see your elevators and forceps and your dental syringe. Keep the side table behind the patient, or at least ask the nurse to keep it on another table behind the patient. No need that the patient see this instrument and to increase his fear. And please use a profound local anesthesia, which is very important. When the patient start dental treatment and he feels no pain, he will be relaxed. And after surgery, after you finished your procedure, your patient needs a further reassurance. Some patients need a telephone call, but this depends on patient characters, because some patients will consider that your call means that there are unexpected complications. He will think, oh, doctor called me today, so I will have a complication. He is expecting that something bad will happen to me. So please make a telephone call for a strong patient's character. But in the fearful patient, avoid this call. Also, the detailed information about expected postoperative sequelae, tell to your patient, for example, for extraction, you may have light bleeding. Don't afraid, just bite on a gauze or tea bag. You may have some pain. Tell your endo patient that swelling is expected after the mechanical preparation. So tell your patients about what you expect. So when he had this complication, he will be ready for that. If he doesn't have this complication, he will tell, oh, this doctor is very good. He told I will have swelling, but I didn't have. So this patient, this doctor is very good. And please give the patients and if these types of patients an effective analgesics to avoid any post-op pain. Okay, so we have to include in our clinic the most important thing, which is the emergency drugs and emergency accessories or emergency equipment. The emergency drugs which should be available in the clinic, among of them, the most important is the epinephrine for the cases of anaphylactic shock, antihistaminics like diphenhydramine and chlorpheniramine malate, okay, are very important for the cases of asthma or allergy. The anticonvulsants like the diazepam are also very important, and antihypoglycemic drugs like we will discuss it later, like 50% dextrose. Glucagon also is very important. Glucose and sugar, at least if you don't have glucose, you have to include some juices in your clinic and some biscuits or some chocolates, which can raise patients' blood glucose level if they have a hypoglycemia. Morphine also is very important for cases of MI. If the patient has an MI in your clinic and he has a severe pain, some analgesics like lignocaine, atropine is very important also. Salbutamol inhaler for the cases of bronchial asthma. Okay, and you have to include the most important thing in your clinic, which are the airway accessories. Please do not start dental procedures without having at least on one oxygen cylinder. The oxygen cylinder should be available in each dental clinic. Also, oropharyngeal airway and nasopharyngeal airways, but the dentist should be practiced to use them. The nasal cannula, face mask, and ambubag are also important to be available in your clinic. So now, if your patients go in a syncope, what are the emergency procedures which you have to follow? I will summarize the emergency procedure for the patients with syncope who had an adequate cerebral infusion or inadequate blood flow to the brain and they fall down in a faint or in a syncope. So please use a MOVE rule, M-O-V-E. Each letter from the word MOVE refers to something. The letter M refers to MOVE. Again, letter M refers to itself, refers to MOVE. Please move your patient to a supine position. Make your dental chair in the supine position if your patient go in a syncope, so that his legs are at or slightly higher than his head. In this position, the blood will flow to the brain by the gravity. If the blood is not going to the brain normally, by gravity, blood will flow to the brain when the patient on a supine position with his legs at or slightly above the level of his head. Then the letter O, oxygen. When the patient has a syncope, without knowing the cause, without searching for the cause, first thing, put your patient on a supine position, then put for him oxygen, and then start the next procedure. You have to put oxygen. Why oxygen? To avoid cerebral hypoxia, to avoid that the brain may have an inadequate oxygen, so he may go in a brain damage, which is the most dangerous thing that may happen to your patient. So the patient has to be put in a supine position, then oxygen, then the letter V refers to vital signs. Then please start to follow patient's vital signs. Measure his blood pressure, measure his blood sugar, measure his pulse rate, respiratory rate, and please measure his temperature. So you will, or you may discover the cause, one of them, you may discover that the cause is the hypotension, the hypoglycemia, is the hyperthermia, is the problem in his heart rate or respiratory rate. According to that, you can manage your patient. And finally, E. E refers to the electronic file. Please return back to the patient electronic file, so that from which you can know the patient medical history. This is the importance of the history taking we mentioned in the first slide. So when you are registering patient medical history and you ask your assistant, please return to the computer, see the medical history or the medical sheet of the patient, you will know, the assistant will tell you that this patient is diabetic, this patient is hypertensive. So you may discover the problem or the cause of the syncope. Okay, so I am asking my audience about the oxygen. Do you have an oxygen cylinder in your clinic? Again, you please don't start the dental procedures without having an oxygen cylinder. As I mentioned, any patient with syncope should be managed with an oxygen at an emergency procedure. So if you don't have oxygen, don't treat your patient even with a simple treatment. Before I had a child, just I inspected her tooth. After I inspected her tooth and I told her that we will schedule for you some procedure, when she came out of the chair, she fainted on the floor. This happened for me. Alhamdulillah, we could manage here by the emergency procedure. But like this patient, she only subjected to a diagnosis. So even diagnosis, you don't start unless you have an oxygen cylinder with you. And not only you should have the oxygen cylinder, you should know how to use oxygen. You should know how to apply an oxygen mask on the patient's face, like the down view. The oxygen mask should adapt well on the patient's nose and mouth. Okay, in this way, it should properly seal the nose and mouth of the patient. Okay, and you have to know the difference between the oxygen mask on the left side and the nebulizer mask on the right side. Oxygen mask is only mask which deliver oxygen from the cylinder to your nose and face. But the nebulizer mask, it contains here a space or a vacancy through which you can put your ventolin and saline according to patient age. So you have to know the types of the mask and how to apply them properly. Okay, we will start by a very important problem which face us in the clinic, and most of the dentists are afraid from when they have a patient with bleeding or when they receive a patient who is under antiplatelet or anticoagulant drugs. Okay, to understand properly the process of bleeding and to understand the effect of the antiplatelet and anticoagulant medication on the patient's health, we have to understand something called the coagulation cascade or the coagulation pathways. Okay, so now I'm in the clinic. I have four patients. One patient is telling to me, I'm taking aspirin. The second patient is telling to me, I have a hemophilia. And the third patient told me that he is under warfarin or coumarin. He's under oral anticoagulant drugs. And the fourth patient told me that he is taking an injectable anticoagulant drugs like heparin, or a pregnant lady, she is taking a clexane. This is common, okay, in the postpartum stage. Delivered woman, she is taking a clexane or a short acting heparin. So to know how to deal with each type of these patients, we have to understand the mechanism of clotting or coagulation. When we have a vessel injury or when we have a cut of our blood vessel, the vessel has a local defensive mechanism which is the local vasoconstriction. The vessel contract to decrease the amount of flowing blood. Like anything, when we have a cut in the water pipe, we try to constrict it or to press on it to decrease water flow. Okay, so the blood vessel tries to constrict in a way to decrease the flowing blood out of the vessel. So this is the first defensive mechanism of our blood vessel, is the local vasoconstriction. Okay, then after a local vasoconstriction by help of some coagulation factors, the platelet plug starts to form to close this open space. Platelets start to make plug. Also again, when we have some water line and and the water is escaping from this water line, if we get some tape, some adhesive tape, we tie it until we repair this line. Okay, the same happened with the blood vessel. Platelet plug start to form to close the opening through which the blood is flowing until coagulation completes. Okay, by the help of some clotting factors, the most important of them is the thromboxane E2, platelets start to aggregate and form a plug here. Some patients are taking aspirin as a protective mechanism against this process. Why? Some patients are highly exposed to a closure of their blood vessel by a platelets, like patients with atherosclerosis, patients with all the history of clotting in their minor blood vessels for the brain or heart, patients with MI, patients with angina pectoris, hypertensive or extremely hypertensive patients. All these types of patients are highly subjected or highly expected to have a clot formed without any cause. So their physician are afraid about them, so they are prescribing an aspirin as a protective. The patient is coming to you, is telling to me, please doctor, I want to extract my upper 7, okay? And you are telling to him, what you are taking? He's telling to you, I'm taking aspirin. Then I see most of my friends are doing that. Please, he's writing on a paper or he's giving it to him verbal instructions. Please stop aspirin for 3 days and then return back to me for extraction. What you are doing, doctor? What you are doing? The doctors are giving to them some prophylactic or some preventive medicine and you are stopping it for a simple tooth extraction. You want to prevent platelet plug from forming on your minor blood vessels in the oral cavity and you are exposing your patient on a 3 or 4 days according to what you told to the patient. You are exposing your patient to have a major problem, to have a cerebral blood clot or to have an MI or having a deep venous thrombosis. So why you are stopping aspirin? Aspirin will work only on the first step of coagulation, which is the platelet plug formation, which takes from 1 to 6 minutes only until the clotting factors form and finally closes your blood vessel. So please do not stop aspirin to your patients who will go in a minor tooth extraction. Please do not stop aspirin. And this is also experienced by me. Now I'm not stopping aspirin anymore. And I did many extractions to my patients with aspirin. They are taking aspirin. Okay, you can just apply a topical gauze or using tranexamic acid, gel foam, anything as a topical hemostatic measure until complete coagulation cascade forms. And also I will tell you a very important information. Actually, stopping of aspirin for 3 days is meaningless. Why? Because the thromboxane E2 and cycle of the platelet formations, actually this process takes from 9 to 10 days. So if you want to stop aspirin properly to have an effect, you have to stop it for 10 days. 3 or 4 days has no effect. Your patient will also bleed because this pathway to stop and that the platelet return to the normal state of formation, it takes 10 days to form. So stoppage of aspirin for 3 days is something meaningless. So my final conclusion in this point, please do not stop aspirin when you are doing a minor oral procedures. Then after platelet plug formation, a coagulation pathways start. And extrinsic and intrinsic pathways. Extrinsic pathway is a liver dependent pathway depending on an clotting factors which are excreted via or through the liver. The most important factor among them is factor 7, okay, which activates the common pathway, the inactive factor 10 to the active factor 10. Okay, so what I want you to know from this extrinsic pathway that there is a short pathway, okay, depends on a factors excreted through the liver. How we can measure these factors by something called prothrombin time. And most recently, we are depending on something called INR, the international neutralizing ratio, in which we divide the BT of the patient on the normal BT. On the normal patient, this INR equals to 1. Okay, for patients under anticoagulants, we may accept it for oral surgery from 2.5 to 3.5. I don't want from you to know much numbers, but I want you to understand the idea. Okay, if the patient is taking oral anticoagulants, he will stop this pathway. Extrinsic pathway will stop, will not work. The liver dependent factors will not work. So the patient is taking warfarin, the extrinsic pathway will not work properly. So the bleeding is expected. So I have to return to the patient physician to consult him about half lifetime of the blood of the drug. So I will ask him, doctor, this your patient is taking warfarin. Tell me the hour and date in which this patient can undergo dental procedure or tooth extraction. He will give you one paper. Okay, doctor, please appoint for my patient tomorrow at 9 a.m. so you can start the dental procedure to him. He will adjust the drug half lifetime. What is the antidote of oral anticoagulant? Is the vitamin K. Your patient is having liver cirrhosis. You have one patient with liver cirrhosis and you are expecting that this patient will have a bleeding, okay, because of the coagulation cascade, extrinsic pathway is not working properly. So what you have to prescribe to your patient, please prescribe to him vitamin K tablets or injection also is better, okay, so that you can counteract the problem in this pathway. Again, I will go to the intrinsic pathway in which inactive factor 12 is activated to active factor 12, which activate the inactive factor 11 to active factor 11. Active factor 11 activate the inactive factor 9 to active factor 9. By the help of factor 8, this is the most important, okay, the active factor 8, okay, turn the common pathway, the inactive factor 10 to active factor 10. Why am I mentioning all this? Because of this point, the active factor 8, in which the patients with hemophilia, I mentioned in the start, some patients will come with hemophilia. In the patients of hemophilia, factor 8 is not available. It doesn't have factor 8. So this pathway will not work. So they are highly exposed to bleeding because the coagulation pathway is not working properly. So I have to return them back to the physician and he should receive a replacement of factor 8 or a whole blood transfusion before starting the dental treatment. And patients with hemophilia should be treated in a hospital, not in the clinic. Even if they are taking the factor 8, they should be treated in the hospital because these are cases of emergency. They may have any unexpected bleeding, so they should be managed as emergency cases in the hospital, because sometimes, again, after you prescribe for them factor 8, they may have perfuse bleeding and they may need for a blood transfusion. Okay, the intrinsic pathway, which depend on a kidney factors or a factors excreted through the kidney, it's measured by something called partial thromboplastin time. Heparin work on this pathway. The patient of heparin or the lady in the postpartum stage who is taking clexane or short acting heparin, she has problem in this intrinsic pathway. Her intrinsic pathway will not work properly. Shows she will has a prolonged partial thromboplastin time. How I should manage this lady? I will also return her back to her gynecologist so he will adjust the half-life time of the clexane. I think it's about 6 hours. It's not our job. The doctor will adjust it. And he will also again tell you, please start extraction tomorrow at 9 o'clock or at 10 o'clock according to the half-life time of his given injection. Okay. Type. What is the antidote of the of this pathway or of the heparin? It's the protamine sulfate. So the patient, simply, the patient is taking warfarin, he will have a prolonged prothrombin time, which is normally from 12 to 15. This patient should be adjusted through his doctor and he should take vitamin K. The patient who is taking heparin, he or she will have a prolonged partial thromboplastin time and she should return to her doctor to adjust the dose of the heparin and to tell me when I should do the dental procedures, and also he may prescribe for her a protamine sulfate to immediately stop the effect of the heparin. Okay, now we will go to the pregnancy. pregnant lady. Most of the dentists, when they receive a pregnant lady, they refuse to treat her as a normal patient. Actually, pregnancy is a physiologic process. She is not sick. Your pregnant lady, she is not ill. She is in a physiologic state. But some precautions should be followed for these ladies. The most important precaution for a pregnant lady is her position on the dental chair and the selection of the procedure you have to do it and selection of the timing or trimester. You have to know at each trimester you can do for her tooth extraction, at which trimester I can do for her scaling, and so on. This is the problem of the pregnant lady. She will have some cardiovascular change. She will have an increased uterine mass, which causes compression on the inferior vena cava, which increased danger of venous stasis and risk of deep venous thrombosis. Also, she will have a hypercoagulable state, which leads to an increase of thrombosis, leukocytosis, and she will have an increased mucosal fragility. She has a risk of airway edema and epistaxis, okay, and usually she loses her lower esophageal sphincter, so she is suspected to risk of reflux, okay, and some hormonal changes like increase in the estrogen, progesterone, thyroxine, steroids, and so on. Okay, let us know what is important to us as a dentist. Actually, please do not go for unnecessary dental procedures. No need to do for this patient's laminate or bleaching or even bridge. Please postpone or the elective procedures till the postpartum stage. This is as a general rule. The most important thing is the position of the pregnant lady. Supine position is avoided, contraindicated. It's not allowed to treat your patient in a supine position. Why? First of all, this patient or this lady, she is suspected to a supine hypotensive syndrome. The supine position will cause to decrease cardiac output, and she may go in hypotension and a syncope. Also, in a supine position, it causes the decrease in the arterial oxygen tension, BaO2, and increased incidence of dyspepsia and gastrointestinal reflux. Why? As we mentioned, because of the loss of the lower esophageal sphincter. And the supine position, as we mentioned in the start, because of the pressure on the inferior vena cava, she is suspected to a deep venous thrombosis and venous stasis through the decreased blood flow in the inferior vena cava. And she may have a clot formation in her inferior vena cava. Okay. So, what is the ideal position for the pregnant lady? The ideal position, as we see in these two pictures, is the gravid position, something called gravid position. Please look to these two photos. On the right side, the patient is lying on her left side, okay, with a slightly elevated legs by a 15 degree, and the hips are elevated by a 15 degree, okay. As you see here in this area, okay, the right buttock and the hip are elevated by 15 degree. Please look to the photo. Okay, this is something called a gravid position. Now see the pressure of the fetus on the inferior vena cava. It's decreased. Now no pressure on the inferior vena cava. It's totally decreased. Some ladies, she cannot withstand in this position for a long time because she will have been in her back. Now her back is not supported, as you see here. Okay, so please, you can put a pillow behind here. Okay, please put a pillow behind here so she will feel a comfort. So this is the gravid position, as you see in the picture. Please, I want you to train one of your assistants on this gravid position so you can know how to properly sit her pregnant lady on the dental chair. And the position on the left side is most uncomfortable, especially for a long procedure in which a pillow is put in on under her right side, as shown in the picture. Okay, so in the first semester, please do the minimal procedures. Why? Because the the fetus now in the process of organogenesis. In the first trimester, the organs of the fetus are forming. Now the organs of the fetus are forming. Okay. What we can do? First, the patient should receive an oral health instructions. She will be educated about the expected oral changes. You have to tell her that you will have some acid refluxes in your mouth. It may cause some ulcers. It may cause bad odor in your mouth. Okay, you have to wash your teeth properly to avoid bacteria inside your blood, and the proper oral hygiene should be formed. You have to tell the patient or to tell the lady what are the expected sequelae that may change in her mouth during pregnancy. You can do some periodontal prophylaxis and some emergency procedures in the first trimester, but please, it's better, especially in countries like KSA with strict rules, okay, you should have a medical clearance from her gynecologist. And please do not do any radiographs in the first trimester, even with a late embryo. In the second trimester, actually, the organs are now completed and formed. So, an emergent dental alveolar procedures can be performed in the second trimester. Like what? Like oral extraction, if it's needed, strongly needed, you can start access preparation. You can do for hair filling, the needed fillings. You can do scaling and polishing if they are strongly needed, if there is calculus that has an adverse effect and that can stimulate the formation of prostaglandins and inflammatory cytokines in her blood, so you can start scaling. Please do for her the procedures that she needs, that they are emergent, that should be done now, and they cannot be postponed till postpartum. But when patient has in class 5 years now or 10 years now, and now she come to do composite, no need. You can put for her only temporary filling till postpartum. In the third trimester, also you can do some dental procedure to her when in the first half of the third trimester. In the first 1.5 months of the third trimester, you can do for her some important or some emergent procedures. In the third trimester, actually, you are not afraid on the baby, because now the baby is a completed fetus. But we are afraid on the lady from the expected complications like fainting, like the reflexes, like vomiting on the dental chair. So maintenance of the oral hygiene, we can do scaling and polishing also again if they are necessary. Also, please control the active oral diseases. If she has fungal infection, oral ulcers, please treat her from these problems. Now, radiograph in the third trimester has at least a side effect on her. Okay, and procedure should not be performed after the mid time of the third trimester, after the half of the seventh month. Yani after 7.5 months, please don't do for her any dental treatment. Finally, we will have a brief discussion about diabetes. Actually, diabetes is a metabolic disorder, and it consists of many types. Type 1 diabetes, which is juvenile diabetes or insulin dependent diabetes, and type 2 diabetes, which depends on the diet and depends on oral hypoglycemic. We have gestational diabetes, and we have many types of diabetes. Also, we have something called diabetes insipidus, okay, which is sometimes called a false diabetes. Okay, how we can diagnose diabetes mellitus? Now we are speaking about diabetes mellitus. Actually, we can diagnose it. The dentist. His role is not only treating the teeth of the patient. He should know at least the normal values of the investigations. The dentist, when he read the investigation of the patient, some dentist doesn't know. Maybe you are diabetic. What did your doctor told you? What did your physician told you? You have to know the normal values of everything. If the patient did a hemoglobin A1C and it's above 2.5%, okay, so your patient is expected to be a diabetic patient. If the patient measured his fasting blood glucose and it's above or equal to 126, so your patient is a diabetic. And if the postprandial blood glucose level 2 hours after the food intake is over or equal to 200, again your patient is a diabetic. And if you do a routine test of your patient and routine random blood glucose level and it's 350 400, it's above 200, this patient already is a diabetic patient. So according to the mentioned parameters, you can simply know if your patient is a diabetic or no. The first question which we should ask to our diabetic patient, which is a common question: did you receive your breakfast? Did you take your breakfast? And did you take your medication? Did you take your tablets, your glucophage, your dimicron? Okay, we have to ask the patient about these two things: meal, did you receive your breakfast, and the medication. Please also again schedule to your patient a morning appointment, and please also follow the stress reduction protocol. The morning appointments are advisable for the diabetic patients. Why we should schedule to our patients a morning appointment? Because of the blood glucose level, or because of another thing? There is something called a circadian rhythm. The suprarenal gland, the gland which is above our kidney, it excretes something called the endogenous cortisol, and it's excreted according to a known time, according to something called a circadian rhythm. The level of cortisol actually increases in the morning, okay, and it decreases gradually till 8 o'clock p.m. It starts from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. So in the morning the level of cortisol will be high. Cortisol is one of the causes or one of the factors which raises our blood glucose level. So that the morning activities are very important. When you want to do any activity, please do it in the morning, because the level of cortisol now is high. You have high of your blood glucose level, you have high blood pressure, everything is proper for the activity to do in the morning. This is the code that we advise usually to do any activity in the morning. So the morning appointment for a diabetic patient is very important. He will have a less chance to develop a hypoglycemia, the most important thing that we are afraid from in the diabetic patient. How you know that your patient is going on a hypoglycemia in the clinic? Now the patient is sitting on the dental chair and he is starting to have a hypoglycemia. How you will know? What are the signs and symptoms? He will start to be sweaty, fatigue, he will have dizziness, he will tell you, I'm drowsy, I'm not concentrating, I'm confused, and he looks pale. You look to his skin, it's pale, no blood. And in some cases he may have some types of convulsions. He will feel weak, he will tell you, I cannot raise my hand, I cannot hold my mobile. He will have some blurred vision, he will tell you, I cannot look well, why? Okay, and he will have an increased appetite. Some patients are telling to you, I feel hungry, why? I don't know, his patient is on a hypoglycemia. In severe cases, he will go in a loss of consciousness, increase the heart rate, and in severe cases, he will have a deep coma. Okay, now if the patient has a hypoglycemia, how can I manage my patient? Please administer 15 milligrams of simple carbohydrates. Okay, and then repeat again the finger stick blood glucose level test in 15 minutes. Simply, you give him some juice. Okay, a bottle of juice, 15 milligrams. Okay, and then again measure the blood glucose level. If the blood glucose level is above 60 milligram per deciliter after taking this juice, so the patient now is good. You can ask him to eat or drink something also to raise his blood glucose level to the proper level, and you can start to him the dental procedure. But if his level remains below 60 milligram per deciliter, please repeat again and give him another 15 milligram of simple carbohydrates and do again the test and continue until the level increase to above 60 milligram per deciliter blood glucose level. But if your patient go in a coma, he became unconscious, please administer to him from 5 to 25 gram of 50% dextrose immediately. Give him an IV route and start to give him a dextrose. Most of us cannot deal with IV route, and maybe some of us doesn't have an experienced nurse who can help us. So if the patient, if semi-obtained patient, yeah, it means he did not go in a deep coma, he is semi-conscious, you can put in his mouth something called glucose gel, okay, on his tongue, and should be available on our clinics, okay, or some types of jelly, something called something which you can put in a tongue which is not in a juice form, because juice will be dangerous on this patient. Of it can go inside the airway, something semi-hard like jelly, any jelly of glucose you put in his tongue, and you have to give your patient 1 milligram of glucagon in an intramuscular way or subcutaneous way. So glucagon is very important. If your patient go in unconsciousness and you doesn't have dextrose, you give him glucagon, which is reverse effect, or which has a reverse effect of insulin. Insulin decrease the blood glucose level, but glucagon increases the blood glucose level. Please repeat your procedure again every 15 minutes and try to establish an intravenous access. You can call the emergency, you can call your nurse doctor to can put for him IV dextrose to save the patient's life. At the end, I want to conclude that most of the, as we see, we could manage most of the dental, of the medical compromised patients in our dental clinic. We should not be afraid from the patient with a systemic disease or a systemic problem. We should know the normal value of everything. We should know the normal value of bleeding time, partial thromboblastin time, prothrombin time, blood glucose level. We should know when our patient will be diabetic or no. We should know the vital signs, the pulse rate, the respiratory rate, the random blood sugar, the normal temperature, blood pressure. We should know all the normal values, because we are not only dentists make filling, we are doctors. We should manage patient as a whole, or but not as an oral cavity. Lastly, I would send my regards to my mentor and to my professor, Dr. Adnan Habib. He was my access to know about this International Dental Congress, which is held online. And great thanks to Dr. Mazen Domeni to give me this opportunity to be part of this Congress again for the second time of this year. And I wish that this Congress will receive a great success, and you will enjoy all the lectures in the Congress. Great thanks. Thank you. Thanks, Dr. Mazen. Thank you, Dr. Adnan. Thanks to all my colleagues. And I welcome anyone to send to me any question. And goodbye.